Hello all, welcome back. So if you have noticed, so far we have done a lot of theory. I have done several examples and answered questions, but as with any language, only practice makes you perfect. So you're going to need to practice a lot. So there's one more topic on sets that I will skip for now. Instead, I'll have about half an hour session where you will solve a problem. I'll give you a simple problem to solve. You are supposed to solve it at your convenience right now. In the next 15 minutes, you solve the problem. Come up with a working solution. Then I will come back, discuss this answer. Okay? And we'll have roughly 1.5 hours like this through the day where you are going to program and I will show you how to program similarly. Okay? The idea is to give you practice on writing Python codes rather than just going through the theory. Okay, the basic commands and syntax, as you have noticed, is very simple. However, without the basic commands and syntax, it's kind of difficult for me to give you a meaningful assignment. So I'll give you 3 or 4 problems now. I'll give you one at a time and I'll give you some 10 minutes depending on the difficulty of the problem. Come back and discuss. Okay. Now, what I will do is I'll switch to the terminal here. Okay. So the first problem I will ask is the following: write a function. Want me to make it bigger? I think this is better. Better, no? Write some function. I won't bother you with calling it some specific name. You can call it f, g, whatever you want. That is given a string. Say s, okay, the variable name is whatever again you choose, and the function returns the number of words in the file, in the string. Okay, very simple problem. All you need to know is string manipulations. So I'll repeat the problem. Write a function that is given a string. Okay? So it takes one argument, that is a string. The function should calculate the number of words in that function, in that string, and return that integer. Okay? That is your problem. Spend about, I will give you till 11:50, about 7 minutes or 8 minutes, and then we'll discuss the solution. So I'll take different problems like this for you to look at, consider. Okay. So the solution to this problem, many people have actually sent it on chat. It's not very difficult at all. So let us look at the solution. I'll write the solution very simply. First thing is, you have to consider that I hope many of you have tried. The importance, I am spending a lot of time on this because if you don't try these problems, you are not going to learn anything from this course. Okay? And next week you will have tests which you will not be able to take. So let us try to solve this problem. So first what we will do is we need to create a function. So def, what shall we call it? Shall we call it word count? And I will give it some input. So I'll call it input. The first thing you have to remember stylistically is you should document your function. So put triple quotes and say notice that my function documentation signature is very clear, it is very precise, counts number of words in the given input string. So, I have also told you what I expect as this function input. Now, we can solve the problem. The input is a string, we simply need to find the number of words. There are many things I actually left unsaid. One of the problems is, what do you do with punctuation marks? Are punctuation marks important? What do you define by a word? So, what we will do is, we will not consider the most general, most complicated problem. We will only say that any set of characters, including punctuation, that are separated by words, separated by white space, are considered as individual words. So, what we will do is, we will first write out, we will split this string. We know that the input is a string. We will split this string based on white space. We know that the split default behavior does this. So, we do not have to do anything special. All we need to do is, input 1. Words is equal to input dot split. Okay. Now, this will basically split every word automatically based on spaces. Okay. Now, to find the number of words, you simply have to do count, right. So, if I look at the length of the words, I should ideally get the correct answer, Hopefully, I will get the right answer. So, let us try this. Please realize that very often programming is not it requires repeated attempts. You may not obviously get first time you write the solution, everything is not going to come out correctly. So, we return length of words and let us see what happens. So, let us try it with, so now comes the next question of, how do I make sure that my code is correct, which actually brings us to an entirely separate concept called test, and I will do that in a little while. So, later this afternoon, I will introduce you tests, how do you test, how do you make tests formal, it is not very difficult, and how this enhances your programming productivity. But for now, we will try to just, what do we normally do as programmers, we will say, we wrote this function, I now have to test it out. So, I will immediately test it with some known input for which I know the answer, right. So, let us try that. So, word count A, B, C, simplest possible sentence, I would expect this to give me 3, is that correct? It gives me 3. So, now one simple way by which I can formalize this process is to use something called, something called assert, which I will come to in a little while, but right now I know that this has 3 words, the answer it is giving me is correct. So, now can I make it little more complicated? What am I worried about? What if I give multiple spaces? Now, what if I give, first thing, what if I give multiple spaces? Does it still give me 3? Let us see. Yes, it gives us 3. Why? Because the split actually considers multiple spaces as one space. It already handles this case for us. So, we do not have to worry too much. Very good. So, this is very good. What if I have a new line? So, let us put a new line inside here. That also works, because the white space includes new lines. What more can we do? What if I add punctuation? Also gives me 3, correct. What if there is some trailing space? Also is fine. However, sometimes people write their text badly. What if I give a comma, if I give a space between the comma and the word? Normally, when you write text, you are not supposed to leave this. So, if I write this a proper sentence, the quick apples, oranges, many people will actually type space comma banana. Unfortunately, this will return 4. Why? Because the comma has space between them. Okay. Sometimes if you put a full stop, you should not put a full stop here. So, it will treat this as 5 words. Okay. Now, unfortunately, some of these are not that easy to handle. Okay. But how can we handle this? Is there a way by which we can easily do, can we handle this in our code? Is there an easy way by which we can handle this in our code? Okay. So, the basic simplest problem works, no problem. But now, if the user makes some stupid mistake, if the text has some, so obviously there will be people who make, who don't write this very carefully, and comma is not a word. So, how do we now fix these problems? The first thing to do is, it always helps to switch to something like an editor. Okay. Because for small tests, you can use Python, the IPython interpreter itself. But once you start having to do something little more complicated, it becomes a little tedious to go back and edit the function. For this, we need two more new concepts. Okay. What I will do is, I will leave this problem at this stage. I will revisit this problem in about 5 to 10 minutes. We will solve some more simple problems to give you more experience, and then we will come back to solving this problem. Okay. And we look at how to solve say this problem of how do you deal with punctuation characters, how do you deal with text having space with punctuation characters, and how do we still get the correct answer. Okay. And finally, once we do that, we will also look at how do I formalize this so that it becomes an easy process for us to follow, so as to write nice clean tests, write clean code, and be able to reuse this. Okay. And to do it properly. So, what we will do now is, the basic problem has been solved. The basic solution is the following. And remember, when you write your solutions, please remember to add the doc strings. It is always a good idea to add the documentation string. Okay. The other issue to remember is, make sure you use appropriate variable names and function names. Don't call this F. I have been doing that just to illustrate to you concepts. But when you are actually trying to solve problems, you have to spend a lot of time thinking about how to solve the problem. And when you think about how to solve the problem, remember, you yourself may reread your code some other point of time. If you just say def F x, no doc string, no comments, and you use variable names that are arbitrary, you yourself will not be able to understand the code that you have written 5 days later, or a week later, or a month, or a year later. And the idea that you should learn, take away from this course, is that when you write your code, you should write it cleanly. You should make sure that the code is reusable. Even the small code bits you write should be reusable, such that later on, you may be able to reuse that piece of code. That is very important. And notice here that I am saying words equals input dot split, because the variable names are up to my choice. You can type slightly verbose names, there is no harm in doing it. So, now it is very clear that I am saying words is input dot split. Okay. And then I am doing len of words, I am returning that, no problem. So, we have solved the simplest possible problem. Let us consider problem 2, which is actually even simpler than this problem, but there are some peculiarities you have to worry about. So, problem 2 is, let us go back to problem 2 is the following. I will give you 5 minutes to solve this problem. Write a function that is given a string, and the function returns the number of lines in the string. Please make sure that again you write a clean function with documentation, with good argument values, good name of the function, whatever you are using inside should be written cleanly. The second thing is, just like how I did the approach, I wrote the function, gave it some test input and checked, oh, okay, this has 1, this has 2. Okay. Try to think of all the corner cases. Okay. Try to think of all the corner cases. What if the file has only has no lines. What if it's an empty file? Should I return 0? Should I return 1? What if it has only one line? What if there's a line at the end which is empty? How do you deal with all of these cases? Okay? Take each case, come up with a suitable test problem saying, oh, this file will have this or this string. And remember, I am not giving you a file, because if you have a file, you have one more file to create. Instead, create a suitable string. So, if I want to say this is the contents of a file, I can say data is triple quoted string, simple space. So, this is a file which contains just one space, not a single new line. What will you consider this? How many lines does this file have? So, you will have to make sure all these corner cases are taken care of. How will you solve this problem? As a hint, please note that if I give you a string, try out the number of methods that that string has. There are certain methods that might be convenient. I want you to explore string methods. So, and part of programming is doing this. Take a problem, come up with, okay, if I give it this, what will it do? If I give it that, what will it do? You have to know how to do this. Please solve this problem, and then I will come back to answering any questions you have about the various, both these problems. The other thing is, the coordinators who are with you are already gone through parts, bulk of this course. So, rather than asking me the question, simple questions, you please ask your coordinators to check, and if they are not able to answer your question, please get back, because it is impossible for me to handle 600 people. That is the reason we did this in two stages. You have a coordinator, please request your coordinator to help you, okay? And then you, if the coordinator is unable to ask, you get back. The other thing is, I do not want you to please start sending me the solutions on the chat session. You start just typing randomly on the chat session, I will start giving you more harder problems. You have to think. Please remember, programming is not learning a syntax. If I teach you Tamil, the language, I can teach you 20 words or 100 words in one day and ask you to by heart. That does not mean you know how to write or speak in that language. You have to use, you have to think, you have to learn to form sentences. You have to take a problem, solve that problem. If you do not solve a problem, there is no point in attending a programming course. For any programming, you must program. Okay? So, and you must do it. You cannot have a proxy or a friend do it for you or a student, nothing. If you want to learn programming, you have to do it. Even God cannot teach you programming. You have to program. Okay? Please remember, you have to program. So, try your best to program. Try to run these programs, test it, give it test input, and think. Don't just immediately give you the first answer. Like yesterday, many of you, when you were doing the function, when I asked you to read the function, many of you just gave the answer straight away without even thinking for 2 seconds. Please do not do that. Think, and please remember, think of all the corner cases. Some of you are typing even now. Don't type me the answer, because your answer is wrong. I'll give you 5 minutes. Think of all of the corner cases. Okay. So, I've given you enough time. It's a very simple problem. I'm just giving many of you time. Some of you may become frustrated. Are simple problem, itna time hum spend kar rahe hain. Problem is, many of you may be new to programming, and many of you may not be able to, not have thought about these things before. And I want to make sure that everybody gets something out of this. If not, I will just go quickly, I can go very fast. So, it is important that everybody gets time to think about this. Okay. So, before we answer this question, some people are having some difficulties. What I will do is, I will get another terminal. So, someone seems to be getting F, apples, oranges, banana. You are getting the answer 4, again, I went through the whole process of explaining why you will get 4 if you give a space after the comma. Okay, on some systems the answer is 3 and some system it is 4, it's because you probably missed a space. So these kind of issues I think you should be able to solve locally with your coordinators. Okay, so please make sure that it's not some silly typographical error that you have made in your code, and it will just unnecessarily take up time. So make sure you're checking with your coordinators. And this problem is very simple. Okay, so the first thing is there are various string methods that you have seen. There are two possible ways of doing. Remember that every problem there may be multiple ways of solving. Some are simple, some will be very very complicated. One way of doing it is you count the number of new lines. Okay, right? So is there a string method I can use to find the number of new lines? The answer is yes. There is string dot. So if I have input okay, now I can do input dot count. Very good. So if I just count the number of new lines, I may get the answer. Okay, but the key to solving this problem is not in just saying, oh, I can have one way to solve it. It's to get the solution correctly for all possible corner cases, which is why I am asking you to think about the corner cases. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to randomly pick some college, pick somebody randomly inside that college, and I'm going to ask you to explicitly give me one corner case that you can think of. So I'm now saying my solution should be def count lines input. I am not going to give a doc string. I will simply return input dot count slash n. And by the way, everybody, every one of you should be comfortable typing in code like this and getting correct answers. Typing syntactically correct code. If you are stuck there, you have a very serious problem and you have to do a lot of work. Okay, make sure you are comfortable typing functions, creating functions, returning values, all of that, indenting, all of this should be easy for you to do. So if I do this, will it always work, will it not work? I am going to test if you guys have actually thought, if all of you folks have actually thought about corner cases. I am going to randomly pick some center. Okay, I am going to switch to some other center because that is not going to work. So let me pick VIT. Yes, please. So yes, now it's better.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you.
Sir, one case is suppose we have two new line character with three sentences. First sentence slash n, some other sentence slash n, some other sentence. This program will give you only count is 2, but the sentence is 3. So in this case, it's wrong.
So you are saying that if we have 3 lines, this program will only return 2 because there are only 2 new lines, correct? Am I understanding correctly?
Yes.
Okay. Fine. That is one good case. Can you, yes. So can you pass the mic to the lady behind you and ask her for one more case?
When I use raw input, can I just give multiple lines, sir?
You are not supposed to ask me a question, you are supposed to answer my question. Na keta kelvi neenga badal sollanum, neenga kelvi ketta seri varadhu ipo. Ni nalla iruke student vandu neenga kelvi ketta student thirupi kelvi ketta neenga ottupeengla. So please answer the, for everybody else I am just telling her she should not ask me a question, she should answer the question I have asked her. So please answer the question, can you give me one more test case? I am talking in English so that everybody can understand. There are many people all over India, they may not understand Tamil. So please give me one more test case which will fail for this. And I gave you 5 minutes to think about this. Can you speak a little loudly? Yes.
I gave 8 lines, sir. I gave 8 lines as my input string. But my output came as 7. Within triple quotes I gave in.
Okay. So but that is the same reason the other. Can you give me another input? Simple case. Okay, so I'll answer the question myself. I'll give you a very simple thank you for your interaction. Simplest case will fail. So if I say count lines A, B, C, this is one line. It's going to give me 0. So just counting this new lines is not going to work. So what if we say default should always be, what if I return plus 1? Right? This may work. Okay, so let's try this. Now it works. Now if I put a new line here, that also works. Now this will also fail. So you should be able to think of one more case that breaks this. Part of the art of good programming is trying to think of, oh, this will not work, that will work, this may not work. So you have to think, exercise your brain a little bit. How do we do that? Exercise your brain. Where will this fail? It will fail for the simplest of all inputs. If I give no, if I give an empty line, it's still telling me one, nothing, I'm giving you an empty file, it is saying it has one line. The same error will happen if I did this following. If I said A, B, slash N, C, slash N, this will give me 3. But it actually has only 2 lines. Okay? So I can't do it. So if there's any line, yeah, or if you have 2 slash Ns together, someone is suggesting that, this will give me 3. When I actually have, I have 2 lines in the file. If you do WC minus L, it will tell you 2 lines, but it's going to give me 3. The problem comes with the simplest case. If I have an empty line, it is treating it as a full line. So we have a problem. So you'll either have to look at all empty lines, remove all empty lines, or you have to rethink our strategy. Somebody came up with the simplest possible solution that was correct. Is to use input dot split lines . So now let us try this solution . So look at how I am solving the problem. I know that I can solve it like this. I know we can use split lines. Split lines will basically ensure that it splits on the lines. I know I can count the number of new lines. There are all these different approaches that I can take, but now comes the problem. How do I test this? I now have to again say, okay, let us try count line 0. Correct. Empty line works. A, B, C, correct. It returns one line. Okay, so what if I give A slash N, B slash N, C, 3? Correct. Right? What if I give 2 new lines? It's 2. So it's perfect. So now remember what the whole process was. I thought about the problem. I wrote some implementation that I thought was correct. Remember, we are going with the assumption that we are going to make mistakes. I start with a problem. I say, okay, I am going to try something. We will first try it, experiment, make sure it works. The second step is, I need to think of corner cases. First, you need to know the language, of course, so that we are all assuming that we have some basic understanding. Now, I need corner cases. So, I take empty file or empty string. Empty string should work. This is one case. Second case, if I have a line with just no new line, but just some content, that should give me one. Second test case. Third case is, okay, I give you some normal input. This should give me 3. Fine? Then fourth case is similar to the first case, slash n slash n, it was giving me 3, now it gives me 2. So for all the known inputs that I have thought about, my function returns the correct answer. This is a common pattern that you will also have to start learning how to use and how to think in this fashion. Write your code, think about what the solution should be, express those cases. Okay, for this input, yes. For that input, yes. For this input, yes. That means the function is correct. So it's a common pattern where you take your function, test cases, that is cases that you know the answer for, run the code against those cases. and determine whether your program is functioning correct or not. Correct? Does this look like a sensible way to program? Supposing, for example, I were to write a function that calculates the square root of a floating point number, of a positive floating point number. So, let us say I define square root of some x and I return some solution. How would I know that this function is correct? The only way I have is, I will say, okay, square root of 2, I know the answer. Square root of 4 should be 2. So, I should say square root of 4, it is giving me 4. I know it is wrong. Okay. So, now I will say, okay, square root of 4 should be 2. So, I should make sure that it returns 2. Okay. Similarly, there will be other inputs that I can supply. I give it 0, it should die, it should give me 0. If I give it 1, it should give me 1. Okay. So, there are various ways by which you can write these little test cases and make sure that your function is. So, this is the way you should think about writing a program at the basic level. The next level is how to make this function clean, how to make it, how do you write your code little better. These are the next things that you need to think about. Okay. So, the question is, you did s is equal to raw input. Remember that raw input will only give you one line. As soon as you hit return on raw input, it will accept that. So, let us see. Notice that it has escaped my slash n. It is no longer a new line. It has put slash slash n. So, if I print this s, it will be exactly that string, that literal string. Okay. So, now if I do count lines s, it will only give me 1, which is correct. So, remember that when you do raw input, if you give it a slash n, it will stringify your slash n. It is not going to treat it as a new line. If you give it as a triple quote, it will work. Okay. That is to answer the question that was posed. Okay. So, what we will do now is, we will switch tracks. We will take one more simple problem and we will try to solve it. So, let us take problem number 3, print out the Fibonacci sequence less than 30. I hope this is visible. Print out the Fibonacci sequence less than 30. I will type it out again for you here. Again, very, very simple problem, not even asking you to write a function, write code, just type it out straight on the interpreter. Many of you may not be familiar with the Fibonacci sequence, but the Fibonacci sequence is as follows. You start with 0 and 1, okay. Then the next number is the sum of the previous two numbers. So, it is 0 plus 1 is 1, then 1 plus 1 is 2. 2 plus 1 is 3, 3 plus 2 is 5, 5 plus 3 is 8, so on and so forth. I want you to write the code to generate this for all numbers for the first 30, that is the number that you get should be less than 30. The Fibonacci sequence till you hit 30 should be printed by you on screen. So, print out the Fibonacci sequence. This is the Fibonacci sequence. So, I want you to print it out less than 30. I will give you 10 minutes to solve this problem. So, it is a very simple problem. Please take the effort to try to get it right. We will use this problem again. We will build on this problem. We will start with just write the pure Python code to solve this problem and take 5 minutes. Okay. So, I have given you plenty of time. Again, very simple problem. How do we solve this? So, the first thing you can do is, you have to start somewhere. Okay. We need the first two values. You have to start at 0. So, let us say a is equal to 0. And we also need some b equals 1. Because we need two values to start the calculation. Okay. Now, I need to do some kind of a check. Okay. But first, these first two values I can print. Should I print or no? what we will do is, we will say while, what should we check for? While A is less than 30, first we will do print A, comma. Why? What am I doing now? So, maybe I should not use the words A is 0 and B is equal to 1. So, first mistake I am making is, what is A and what is B? The meanings of the words are not that clear. So, what I can say is, current equals 0, next equals 1. Simple. While current is less than 30, print current. Now, I need to get the next. Now, I have to do a swap, right? I want the current to become 1, the next to become 1 plus 0. Is that correct? So, how does this proceed? If you go back, this is current, this is next, right? I want to first swap, I want to make current 1 and proceed produce the next, which is previous plus current. So, what is the, I want current to become next, which is the next value, which is already 1, and I want next to become current, or rather I want current to become next and next to become current plus next. So, how do I do this? I have to use either a temporary variable, but in Python I can do it much simpler. I can simply say current comma next equals next comma current plus next. Correct? What am I doing now? In this one line, I am saying current is becoming next, and when the right hand side is evaluated, none of the variables have changed. So, it is first evaluating current plus next, which is what? 0 plus 1, which would be 1. Current is becoming next. Anything else? Should I change anything? Nothing. Finished. There is my solution. Notice that the solution is extremely simple. I know the answer. So, obviously, first time you are doing it, you will struggle. You will make mistake, you will do something or the other. But eventually, you should arrive at this solution, and notice how simple it is. I am simply saying current is 0, next is 1. While current is less than 30, print current. Current comma next is next comma current plus next. So, the key is here, which is saying set the current to the next and set the next to the current plus next. And you, the important fact to remember is the right hand side is evaluated at the current point, at before this current is set to next, it is evaluated. If not, there is no point in doing this. You are essentially using the same idea that we use for swapping of variables. Another way of doing this, perhaps the more simple way to do it is, temp is next, current is next, and next is equal to temp plus next. Obviously, this won't do anything. Current is 0. So, current comma next, I can now simplify this as current comma next is 0 comma 1. Run this code. Why didn't this work? In fact, the answer is wrong. The answer is wrong because I said temp is next, temp should be current. So, let us repeat this. This is correct. So, obviously, you will make some mistakes, but notice that when you are trying to save a temporary variable, it is always a little tricky. Which one do you save, which one do you not save? Your obvious trick is you are setting current here, so you want to save that. That is the reason you are doing it. Okay? But notice how much simpler this code is. It is essentially doing the following. That is it. So it is syntactically easier, it's much easier to cognitively follow, and it produces the right output. Okay, so very good. So now we have our little Fibonacci function that produces code. Now the next thing is to make this into a function. So the next little assignment is, this is very, very easy. All you need to do is introduce a function. Okay. However, what I will do now is, I will show you, I will switch to writing this in a separate file, so that you are comfortable writing programs and learning how to do it as a, in a development workflow. So in some directory that you want to keep all your code, ideally your home directory, I am going to create this file called fib. Okay. I will write my original solution. Same exact solution, I have put it into a file now. What I will do now is, okay, I will keep the file active. I will switch back to my IPython interpreter. First thing I need to make sure is I am in the same directory that this file was created. So ls, yes, it is there. If not, if in some other crazy directory, you do cd whatever full path to the directory slash blah blah, okay. Normal cd command that you know how to use already, use it to cd into that directory. Now that this file is there, I want to run this code. To run it, IPython has this built in called run. So do percentage run fib.py. What percentage run does is, it executes that code in a separate Python like environment to produce the answers. Okay. So for example, if I do del current next, I run fib.py, notice that I have the variables from my execution. Okay, so, this is a very convenient mechanism by which you can execute your code and also see what is going wrong. For example, let me make that mistake I made before. I say, and now I will run this. Now let's print current. It's 32. It's wrong. So I have the opportunity to inspect any variables. Print next. It's 64. Okay, so it's doing something wrong. Come back to this. Edit it. Make whatever corrections I want. Huh? It's gone. So how do I stop? Control C. Obviously this won't work because next. So if you get stuck, you hit a Control C. Now run it again, it runs. Okay. So the strategy is, if you want to write little more complicated code, create a file, call it something nice, remember, it helps to make this file that you don't call it 1.py, 2.py, don't use numerals. Make sure that the variable names that you use, the file names that you use are valid variable names. Don't put minus, use underscore, don't use spaces in your file names for Python files. There's a reason for this, I'll explain the reason in a little while. But the general rule is, and valid variable names are what? Anything starting with an alphabetical character, it can contain letters, digits, and underscore. It cannot contain arbitrary punctuation marks, no comma, no space, no minus, no and, no hash, valid variable name. So, anything alphanumeric plus underscore is the valid variable names. Use something that's a valid variable name. So, don't use 1.py, it's not a variable name, 1 is a literal. Okay, use 1.py if you really must say 1, okay, fine. So, now I have a mechanism by which I can write the code in a nice editor and execute it inside Python, inside IPython, and be able to debug and figure out what's going on. So, let me change it back to the nice clean version. It works. Okay. Now, what is the next problem? Convert this to using a function. So, let's go back to our file. Now we have the arduous task of notice that I am using spaces for all of this. Notice that now it didn't do anything. Why? Because I have not called that function. My code has only defined this function, it has not called the function. So, there are two ways to do it. One is, I either don't call it there and call it here, or I add a line here saying, okay. However, this is inconvenient. Every time I run it, it will automatically run that function. If I put two functions, which function do I call? So, it becomes a bit of a headache. So, let us not call it here. Let us call it explicitly from within IPython. Okay? So, I want you to do this, create a file called fib.py, write this function, but now modify this function to take one argument called n, and it should print Fibonacci sequence less than n that you supply. Very simple modification. Please make this modification, write a file, save it, and learn how to run it from IPython like so, like the fashion I have shown you. Okay? So, please do this 5 minutes. It won't even take you 2 minutes to do it. Please do it 5 minutes. As soon as you do this, we will break for lunch. Okay? We will join a little bit, we'll give you additional 10 minutes at lunch break. But I want you to go through this exercise of creating a file and running it in IPython. Okay. Please do it. Hello. So, we are back. So, the answer is extremely simple. You must have just taken time to type out the code and all of that. So, let us say n, and I will just say change the documentation string as well. Okay. Now, this has become a nice function. I go back into my IPython, run it. Now I can call, if I call fib now, it will tell me it's an error. Why? Because fib takes exactly one argument, you have given me 0. So let's now call it with 30. That works. 300. That works. 3000. That works. 30,000. That also works. So the advantage is, because it's a nice function, I can just have it, I can call it with different arguments and get the results. Okay? So this is your, this is the general workflow that you will employ when you are writing your own codes. You will have an editor editing your Python file, writing your code there, and you will have an IPython session when you will be trying out these stunts. Okay, call this function, okay, now this is correct, this is not correct. So it gives you a clear way by which you are able to edit your code in a nice environment, test your code interactively by using IPython's run command. Okay? And every time you change that file, it's a good idea to do a run of that command. Okay? So with this, we'll stop, we'll pause, we'll break for lunch. After lunch, we will resume solving these little problems, making them more and more complicated. And then we'll do some test-driven development and some other advanced notions. Based on, we'll build on these small little chunks of code that we are writing. So most of the session, rest of the day will be mostly interactive. We'll probably have a test again. We'll make some modifications to our server to make sure you don't get these connection errors. We'll have you all log in again and take the test once again. We'll try that. So we'll join for lunch, post lunch at about 2:15, sometime at 2:15 to 2:20 we will join. Okay. See you soon.